Hi, and welcome back to myexcelonline.com. Today, we are going to do a different kind of video for you. We are going to go over some vocabulary in Microsoft Access because Microsoft Access just has so many words, and we thought doing a video to just introduce some of these terms would be really helpful to you as the end user in your learning process. If you want to learn more about Microsoft Excel and Office, join our Academy online course and access more than 1,000 video training tutorials so that you can advance your level and get the promotions, pay raises, or new jobs. The link to join our Academy online course is in the description. So here's the database that I created on our beginning access video. And I'm just hoping to go through a whole slew of things in here so you can understand what these words mean when we're using them on our videos. So first of all, what is a database? And in particular, what is an access database? Because a regular database is usually a series of tables and maybe some queries where all of this centralized data is located and many different kind of programs pull that data out. So that can be Microsoft Access, but it can also be like SQL Server or Oracle. It can even be an Excel spreadsheet or a text file. It's just anywhere data resides is usually called a database. But a Microsoft Access database is a little bit different because you have all of those tables in it and maybe some queries, but you also have other objects. You can have forms and reports and macros and modules. And all of those objects combined together into a single file is called an Access database. So Access combines all of those different kind of objects into a single file that allows end users to access the data in the tables, edit the data in the tables, view the data in the tables, and perform functions on the data inside the tables. But a very, very simple definition of a database is a way to store, organize, change, add, or delete data. So inside Access, I've been using the word objects. So what is an object? An object for Microsoft Access is either a table, a query, a form, a report, a macro, or a module. And if you see the list over here on the left on this navigation pane, you can see that we have one or more of each type of object inside of our database. And if I use this down arrow right here, I can look at one object type at a time. So if I just wanted to see my tables, I could hit tables. If I just wanted to see everything I created by a certain date, I could just hit created date. Or if I wanted to see all my objects, I could just go to object type and then hit all access objects. So let's go through each one of these object types to give you a better definition. A table is pretty much a spreadsheet. If I double click on the table, you can see that I have rows of data in here. Each row of data is called a record, and each column I have in my table is called a field. So if I go to design view of this table, I can just right click and go to design. There's a couple more things I want you to see in here. A data type is the type of data that is allowed in this field. So if I click on this down arrow here, you can see that I can allow text, different kinds of numbers, dates, currency, yes, no, a hyperlink, an object, and so on. You can also see that I have something here called an ID, and that data type has been set to auto number. And this is a special kind of field because see this key over here? This is called a primary key. So if I right click here and I go back to my datasheet view, the purpose of my primary key is to uniquely identify each record. And so when you look at these two records that have the same manufacturer name, same address, city, state, etc., it has two different IDs. So I might have a reason for having information in my database that has more than one record. Like what if I had this manufacturer, but I had a different contact? I would make the argument that that doesn't belong in this table, but we can talk about that some other time when we talk about different kinds of relationships. But for now, I just want you to see that it's possible to have two records that have the same data, and there's no way of telling this record from this record unless I have a field that is forced to be unique, and that is called a primary key. If I open up my parts table, you can see I have this column right here, which is part manufacturer ID, and it has a number, and this number relates back to the primary key of the manufacturer's table. So in the manufacturer's table, the ID is called the primary key, but in the parts table, it is called the foreign key because it's pointing to a foreign table. I'm going to close those up and give you another access word. If I go up to database tools, I can hit this button that says relationships. A relationship is a way for the data in one table to have to come from another table. So in this case, our parts manufacturer ID comes from our manufacturer's table, and it creates a relationship between those two tables. Now, there are three different kinds of relationships that you can have. So I'm going to close this, and let's look back at my data to understand these kinds of relationships. So if I open up manufacturers and parts, you can see that there's one instance of every part number, and each one of those part numbers has a manufacturer. But in this case, there's one part number, but there could be the same manufacturer for multiple part numbers. So there is a one to many relationship between part number and manufacturer. If the part number only had one manufacturer per part, then I would have a relationship that is called a one-to-one relationship. But sometimes there is a case where there are many part numbers and many manufacturer IDs. So it is possible that more than one manufacturer could manufacture this part, and this manufacturer could manufacture more than one part. In that case, that's called a many-to-many relationship, and that's a little more complicated, and that's outside the scope of what we're doing today. I just want you to know that a many-to-many relationship exists. If you are liking this video, please give us a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel, and hit the bell button to get notified when we release our weekly videos. So I'm going to close these, and let's move on to queries. And then I'm going to open up the query that we built last time into Design View. So inside of a query, you have two tables that are joined by a relationship. It is possible to have only one table in a query with no relationships going on, but in this case, we do have a relationship. And so down here, you have different field names and different table names. So in this case, I want the part number, but if you look down here, the part number is coming only from the parts table. The part description is coming from the parts table. The manufacturer name is coming from the manufacturer's table. So when I have a relationship inside of a query, I have options of which table that field is going to come from. Another thing inside of a query is right down here. This is called criteria. And what the criteria does is it allows you to limit the number of rows that are coming back based on the criteria that I enter here. So if I run this query right now, you can see I have lots of data coming back. But if I go back to design and I pick the state of Texas, which you can see is in double quotes, and it's not case sensitive, by the way, and I view that again, you can see that that criteria has limited all of my results to only a single state. I also have a way to sort my data, and that is ascending or descending. But by default, it's not sorted. And I also have a totals field up here. So if I had sales by manufacturer, I could put the manufacturer's name and I could get a summation of all the sales for that manufacturer. This is very, very similar to a pivot table inside of Microsoft Excel. With this, I'm not just limited to totals. And let me show you, even though it doesn't really make sense to do this type of query for the data that we have right now, I just want to show you your options. So I will see a totals field right here, and I can get out some of the same functions that I can from a pivot table. So it's a sum, an average, a min, a max, a count, a standard deviation, the first, the last, etc. And each one of these things in here is called an aggregate, because I probably have multiple sales per manufacturer, so I am summing up every line that has a sale from that manufacturer. And one more thing about queries. We have different types of queries up here: select, make table, append, update, crosstab, and delete. We also have more complex ones over here in this list. So I'm going to close that, and let's talk about forms. So if I open this form in design view, you can see everything on a form is called a control. And I can have various kinds of controls on a form if you look up here. I can have a text box. And a text box generally is a window to a field in a table, or it could be a calculation based on other data. And an example of a text box would be the part number right here coming from the part numbers table. I can have a label, which is how I would like to label my text box. So this label, part number, is just the words part number labeling this text box. This is a button that the user can click and run some actions. These are some folder tabs, kind of like this tab that you see up here on the screen. You can put some of those on your form. This would be an option group where you could present the user with a couple different options and they can click maybe yes or no or a color or something else like that. And there's a few others here that we can go over. Here's a combo box when a user wants to make a choice of one item in a box. And here's a list box for when a user wants to select one or more in a list. This is a checkbox for a yes/no field, and this is a picture. And down here is a subform, and we will go over those more in detail later on. So every one of these items in here is called a control, and a control is an object that is placed on a form. If I right-click on any of these controls on my form, I can see down here that there is an option for properties. I can also access the properties by clicking this button up here. When I click on that, I can see something called the property sheet appearing. Properties are adjustments you can make to a control for various things. If you go look across the tabs at the top, I can change the format of the control. I can change the data source of where this data is coming from. I can change any events, and what events are things that happen to trigger code running on your form. And I also have other options I can do under this All tab. If I go over here and I click on a label instead of this text box, you can see up here that this changes to label. I can also use this pull down box to pick all the controls on my form and see the properties for that control. But for now, I just want you to know that properties are various things you can change to change the look and feel of those controls. So if I close that and go in design view of my report here, it's very, very similar to the form that we just looked at. I can have each of these controls also on my report. And these fields are coming from my manufacturer's table right here. So this is displaying the manufacturer's name, the address, the city, the state, etc. And once you master form design, report design is rather easy. But you can see you have tons of options here for reports. You can add totals, you can put charts in, you can pretty much do a lot of the same stuff you can do in Excel in the reports for access. And you can design them to be a lot more user-friendly. You can put a logo on here, you can put a title on here, you can insert page breaks exactly where you want them to be, and you can also do conditional formatting like you can in Excel. So two more objects. This one is called a macro. And if I go into design view, a macro can do a whole slew of actions. So a macro is a really quick way to do stuff inside of your database. Like look at some of these simple tasks. You can save a record, you can run code, you can open a form or a query or a report or a table, you can go into print preview, you can send a message box to the user. And up here, you can even use if statements inside of your macros. Macros are a great way to start doing actions inside of Access because they're not as complicated as the next thing I'm going to talk about. And we will have a video on macros really soon. So I'm going to close that and just show you right here. Your modules down here are essentially VBA. So if you're used to VBA in Excel, this is just another way to see them in Access. If I double click on one, I will be brought right to the VBA window and I can start writing code here. VBA stands for Visual Basic for Applications. And it is the coding language used in all of Microsoft Office products. And again, we will go into that way more in depth. So I'm going to close that for now. And hopefully that's been a good overview of some of the access terminology, and Microsoft Access doesn't seem so foreign to you now. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them below, and we'll get back to you soon. Thanks for watching, and see you next time. If you want to learn more about Microsoft Excel and Office, join our Academy online course and access more than 1,000 video training tutorials so that you can advance your level and get the promotions, pay raises, or new jobs. The link to join our Academy online course is in the description.
If you like this video, subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you're really serious about advancing your Microsoft Excel skills so you can stand out from the crowd and get the jobs, promotions and pay rises that you deserve, then click up here and join our Academy online course today.